interesting, I guess.
Okay, hello everybody. So we are going to talk about the Pic du Midi, and before talking about adaptative optic, I'm gonna tell you a few words about the history of the telescope in the last few years. In fact, this telescope is not very young. It was built in 1963, so this telescope is older than me. I'm going to celebrate my birthday Saturday, and I will be 40, so the telescope has 15 years more than me. But despite the age of the telescope, it's still doing a lot of good science. So at the beginning, the telescope was built in order to help NASA to observe the moon, to find some places, some landing sites for Apollo missions. So that's why it was built at the beginning of the 60s. And even at this time, the telescope was able to do some crazy images. They were very famous all over the world because of their quality. It was the best place in the world to make some planetary imaging, like we can see with this Argentic image of Saturn. Then in the 19 came the CCD device. So we get, at this time, the astronomer get more and more good images. And then I started to observe with this telescope 15 years ago. And the first time we put a video camera, a web camera on the telescope, Vesta Pro, and we obtained this image of Saturn that have been famous at this time because we were able to see a lot of details, but it was just a webcam, so it's obvious that we can do something better with better camera. And that was coming in the next few years with the black and white CCD device. And we also put a refraction corrector on the telescope in order to correct the prism effect of the atmosphere. So at this time, we started to have good images, but the problem of the telescope is the focal length. You have 17 meters focal length. It's very long. And if we took at this time the fast video camera, the ships was too small for the focal length of the telescope. It was not possible to make a full image of Jupiter and Saturn. So at this time, 10 years ago, we had to wait, in fact, a few years again, to have better device that were able to run something like 50 images per second. So this is what we have since a few years. We have some new sensors made by Sony that are both fast enough and big enough for this telescope. And now we get some very good image quality. This one was made 1 year ago. And I think that most of you have seen the images made by Marc Delcroix and Damien Pitch and other guys and Ricardo also in June. They had an even better result than this one. What I'm sure of is that if you take this image of Mars, it seems to be impressive, but Mars was something like 20 or 25 degrees over the horizon. It's the same for this image of Saturn, and it's the same also for the images made last June. So I'm sure that we can still improve this telescope. We are not at the limit of the telescope, and we are not at the limit of the observatory. So what can we do next? Of course, we are thinking about an adaptative optic system. So we have started to discuss about that many years ago with Imagine Optic, that is an enterprise near Paris. They are specialized in wavefront sensor of the Shackartman wavefront sensor. And they also make some adaptative optics, but for most of the time, it's for medical device to make some images of the eyes. They need also some wavefront sensor and adaptative optic. So in fact, the main problem was to find a deformable mirror that was not too expensive to make something affordable. We want to have a system for Pic du Midi, but we also want to have a solution that could be interesting for other observatories. So we want to make an industrial device that other people could buy. So we have discussed a lot with them this year, and since it makes 1 year that we have very serious discussion about that. and they have started to work on the device this last month, and they have made this design. So the goal is to make something that is under 20,000 euro, that is a lot of cheaper than the other device that you can find for make some an adaptive optics. So it's still expensive for an amateur, for instance, but for a professional telescope, it's a quite cheap device. So if you look inside the box, the light comes from here. It goes on a flat mirror, then it goes on here on the deformable mirror. It goes after on a semi-reflective glass, and then you have one part of the light that goes to the Schartmann and the other part that goes to the camera. So you can put any kind of camera you want on this side, and this side will be a standard 2-inch piece to put it on any kind of telescope. So the device will be able to work, of course, on the 1 meter telescope, so it can go up to F over 17, but it will be also to run on telescope with F to 10. You have just to move some position of lenses inside the device. It's not very difficult to adapt it from a telescope to the other. The field will be of 8 by 8 millimeters on the 1 meter telescope, so you have to make a conversion if you want on a smaller telescope. The deformable mirror have 40 points of deformation. The wavefront sensor is a compromise. In fact, you don't have to have too many micro lenses on the wavefront sensor in order to have enough light to analyze. This wavefront sensor is able to run to 1,000 hertz, so it's quite fast. But of course, you can choose the speed of the analysis. It depends on what you want to do at the end. At the end, we have a correction of about 100 hertz on the magnitude 5 target. So it means that we will able to do this kind of correction on target like Mars, Saturn, and Jupiter. That's interesting. And of course, if you want to shoot a fainter target, you have to change the rate of the analysis, but you will also change the rate of the correction, of course. So the goal is to have a Strel ratio of 0.8 in the visible part of the spectrum. So the goal is to reach the diffraction limit of the telescope, of course. And to finish on the description of the device, you have this part that is interesting. In fact, it looks like a filter wheel, but it's not a filter wheel, it's a wheel for semi-reflective glass. That means that you can choose which part of the light you want to use to make some images and which part of the light you will select to make the analysis. So you can make some images in the infrared and making the analysis and in the visible, and you also can also make the inverse. If you want to make some infrared image of a methane image of Jupiter, for instance, you can make the analysis in the visible part of the spectrum, and you have several positions on the wheel, so you can make a lot of different kind of selections. So the device is nearly complete. No, I think that's the optical bench they have done at Imagine Optique. But I think right now everything inside the box. So you see the different elements, the Schartmann here the deformable mirror, and after the flat mirrors and everything. So right now we are nearly ready to make some tests. For the moment, the only limit is the software. We still have some development to make on the software, because right now we are just able to make some analysis on target up to 4 arc seconds. And of course, the goal is to be able to make some analysis on bigger targets like Jupiter or on Saturn. We know that it's possible, but it's just a question of time. In fact, there are two goals with this device. In the case of peak humidity, we don't need so much to have an adaptive optic because we already have a very good sky. But of course, the adaptive optic is interesting, but there is another point that is more interesting for us, is the fact that with this device, you can also correct the default of the telescope. If you have some astigmatism, for instance, that's something very common on telescope bigger than, I would say, 40 centimeters. And the device will be able to correct this kind of default. So you can use it with a slow rate of analysis and a slow rate of correction just in order to have the equivalent of an active optic. So it's very interesting for the small professional telescope and, of course, for the amateur telescope in the range of 50 centimeters to 1 meter. And for peak humidity, the adaptive optic is interesting to make this kind of images in the methane band. It's very difficult to do this kind of images because the frame rate you use is very slow, like 5 or 10 images per second. And in this case, for peak humidity, the correction will be very interesting, and I am sure that we will be able to improve the quality of this kind of images. And the other target very interesting for us is the outer planet of the solar system, like Uranus and Neptune. We should be able, I think, to improve the quality of the images we obtain on this planet because we already have a good quality of this planet, but I'm sure that we can get better image quality with this device. So now the plan is to make some tests on the sky, and we should do it at the end of the year, I think at the end of October or the beginning of November. Of course, it depends on the quality of the sky, and I hope that it will work, and next time I will come to show you some results. That's it. If you are, yes?
Yeah, for a large object and a round object, like Jupiter, what would you use for a guide star?
In fact, we'll make the analysis directly on Jupiter. Some guys at ONERA in France already have some, they know how to do it. In fact, we have to discuss with them, I think, but they are able to make the analysis directly on the planet. And it seems that it works. It's not obvious, but this guy says that it works. And I think they know what they say, but in fact, it's the main part we still have to develop. Right now, the software is able to analyze some target of 4 arc seconds, and we have to enlarge this angle, of course.
Any other question?
Can you tell me how close you are already at the diffraction limit of the
objects? Yes, we will reach the diffraction limit, yes. That's the goal, yes. In the visible part of the spectrum, the goal is to have the diffraction limit. In fact, an adaptive optic it depends also on the quality of the sky. It's obvious that if you put an adaptive optic in a bad site, it will not work because the device have a limit in the correction, in the analysis, and for this kind of device, at the beginning, you also need a good sky. So you have to have a telescope in a good place and having a good night. For the bad night at peak humidity, the device will not work. But the goal is to improve the image quality for the good night that we have, and we have a lot of them at peak humidity.
Mm-hmm. apologies, I haven't really thought through it, but you would use locking imaging technique on in the same way?
Yes, of course. Yes. We use both techniques, but in fact, the interest of Lucky imaging in the case of peak humidity is to correct the tilt, but the device will also correct the tilt. So in fact, we have to try, but maybe we will be able to make some longer exposure in order to decrease the noise.
I am aware that does have access to adaptive optics, and but I'm not aware of any amateurs that are actually using it at this stage.
I think I've seen a few images done at the Observatory of Nice or people from that area, but those devices are just correcting the motion of the planet. So that corrects the first order, and that's different. That's higher order correction.
Yes,
and it's like improving the scene by a factor of 2 or 3 and then putting your fast camera. So it's like observing at 0.3 arc second scene.
But as I said, in the case of Pic du Midi, it will mostly be interesting for technical imaging like the methane band. Because for the rest, with the Lucky technique, in fact, we already have some good quality. But since Jupiter is getting lower and lower, it will be more and more useful to have this kind of device.
So the acquisition is in the video mode, or it's a single CCD image?
Yes, at the focus, the goal is to still use the same kind of camera as we use today. In fact, with the device, you can put any kind of camera you want. So we will still.
You first made the adaptive optics, and then you made the Lucky imaging of the images corrected by the adaptive system?
Yes, I think that's what we are going to do, yes. But after, we have to make some try to see if it's still necessary to make some Lucky imaging. Maybe we will be able to make some very longer exposure, but my feeling is that making both Lucky imaging and correction on the deformable mirror is what will give the best result, but we have to make some try, in fact.
And for the secondary mirror in the imaging, what is the size of the secondary mirror? I don't remember. Because it should.
Yes, the size is about 30 centimeters, but I don't remember the exact.
It's like that, yes, more or less.
Yes. The obstruction is around 30%, so I think it's, but I don't remember the exact size.
Okay, so I think that with this we end the Aura part of the amateur sessions. We still have few amateur posters in the session tomorrow on Thursday. So before we finish this talk, I just want to remind you that the Europlanet is a big project. One of its branches is to promote amateur astronomy through all of Europe, that there are some resources to also promote activities and bring some amateur astronomers from non-European countries to these events. And we will be working to improve these observations and relations with professionals, and so that next year we will even have a better and more interesting amateur set of sessions in Berlin. So thank you all for coming.
Thank you.